So you're going to hear from some terrific people this weekend, throughout the weekend, on a range of topics. Things like income inequality, redistribution, socialism, socialism in Latin America, President Trump's economic strategy, from one of his economic advisors, Steve Moore, and others. But I thought we'd start off the weekend by talking about something a little bit more foundational: the role of business in society today. So I want to open up the floor as we get started. Give me a few definitions of what you think the role of business is today in society. Yep. To improve the lives of the consumer. Okay, what else? Yep. Okay, helping regulate the economy of a country. What else? Yep. Encouraging trade, okay. And I'm not looking for any right or wrong answers here, it's just an open-ended question. Maybe one more, yep.
Supply and demand.
Okay, what do you mean by that? Supply and demand, okay. Okay, so supplying the demands of the customer, the consumer, okay. Great. So what I want to do is specifically discuss an argument that you've probably heard, and if you haven't, you probably will sooner or later. It's the argument of people over another P word, profits. People over profits. Who's heard something like that before? Okay, looks like most of the room. And anyone who's taken any courses on economics or business or just read anything related to that, raise your hand. Okay, maybe half, a little more than half the room. And raise your hand if you think you want to enter the business world in some way, whether now or in the future. Maybe you want to become an entrepreneur, maybe you want to work for a business, maybe you want to make a lot of money. Okay, good percentage of the room. So I think we're on the same page here. I want to jump right into the argument of people over profits. This idea of businesses prioritizing profits over people has increasingly filled our discussion today, right? You hear it from leaders in office, people like Alexandria Ocasio-Cortez, Bernie Sanders. You probably hear it in schools, in your communities. You probably read about it in history books, which talk about the robber barons, people like Andrew Carnegie or John D. Rockefeller, who are often made out to be evil people, right? They succeeded in business at the expense of other people. Earlier this year, two senators, Senators Chuck Schumer from New York and Bernie Sanders from Vermont, wrote the following in the New York Times. Businesses once shared a belief that they had a duty not only to their owners, but to their workers, their communities, and the country that created the economic conditions and legal protections for them to thrive. But over the past several decades, business leaders have become obsessed with maximizing financial success to the detriment of workers and have helped to create the greatest income inequality in decades. That's word for word what they wrote. So here's basically the translation of what they said, right? It's that businesses have an obligation to society as a whole, all of us, rather than to the people who invest in the businesses, the owners of the business. So let's take a closer look at that, because I think it's important. And as you go through your careers, and certainly as you enter college, you'll hear about it. You'll hear this argument thrown around, and I want you to be prepared for it. What's interesting is that it's not just government leaders making this argument, it's also business leaders, the people who you think should be representing the ideas of entrepreneurship and business success. The case these critics are making is that businesses are prioritizing pure financial gains, how much money the businesses bring in, how much profit they earn, over the well-being of the rest of us, people. And by people, they seem to include everyone except the business owners themselves, right? So customers, all of us are customers of one form or another, They mean employees of the business, the people who work at the business, make it possible for the business to produce the products and services that they deliver. They mean society as a whole. But there are some practical problems with this argument, right? Probably the most logical question you would ask if you were to hear this is, how is it that a business can be successful, financially successful, if it doesn't actually help someone, if it doesn't actually help individuals? Some of the answers you gave earlier reflected this, I think. So how can it be that a hugely successful business like Apple or Amazon or even an oil and gas company like ExxonMobil, how can they be profitable without providing products and services that all of us actually want and purchase? Take the iPhone. All right, I've got an iPhone 6 here, and it's got a cracked screen, so it's not the newest one. You might laugh at me for having an old version of the iPhone, but let's take a newer iPhone, right? The iPhone XS. That can cost you over $1,000. $1,000. That's a lot for a little device that you can hold in your hand. You could put that away for college tuition, maybe, or maybe you bought a car and you need to pay down a loan. Maybe your parents bought a car and need to pay down the loan. But we choose to buy an iPhone. Why do we do that? It's because it adds tremendous value to our lives, right? And I don't just mean allowing us to stare at it when we're in an elevator uncomfortably standing around 10 different people. Real value. You can stay connected with your parents. Maybe you're home late. You're going to get home late from soccer practice. Maybe you're in an emergency. You can get a hold of your parents from literally anywhere in the world. You can maintain your schedule on it. I'm sure, if not all of you, most of you probably have a whole list of extracurricular activities you do outside of your own schooling, whether it be sports or the newspaper or Young Americans for Freedom. And you don't need to remember exactly when those activities are or where they're going to take place. You can just look at your phone if you want. You've probably got it stored away. You can store all of your contacts on it. There was a time when you actually had to remember people's phone numbers. I don't remember anyone's phone number except mine today. And I'm guessing that's probably the case for most of you. If you choose to, you can virtually manage your entire life on this little device. It's hard to put a price on that. But let's take another example. Why is ExxonMobil, which was originally founded in 1870 by John D. Rockefeller as Standard Oil, why is ExxonMobil still around today? Why is it still successful? Why is it still a profitable company? And why is it able to employ more than 70,000 people around the world? Because its main products, oil and natural gas, are products that power our way of life. I mean, we literally depend on those resources to help us function as a society. By and large, businesses benefit people across the board and around the world. Whatever you're standing in life, whether you're a billionaire or you're part of the middle class, or you're part of the struggling class, making it tough to make ends meet. So let's take some different groups of people that the critics of entrepreneurship and business claim are harmed by businesses. The obvious one, which we've talked about a little bit, would be consumers, right? You and I are consumers of probably hundreds, if not thousands, of products, I mean, in a given year. And the critics argue that businesses succeed because they take advantage of consumers like you and me. But let's look at it a little bit different way. We fill up our cars at the gas station every week so we can drive to school or drive to work, to purchase groceries, to go to the store. Airplanes allow us to fly across the country, across countries, for some of you coming from Canada. They do that on jet fuel produced by a business like ExxonMobil. You and I are people who are served well by a business like that. We don't always think about it as we go about our day-to-day lives, but without it, our lives would look a whole lot different. I certainly don't know how to explore for oil. I don't know if you do, but I don't. I don't have the resources to assemble a team and get the technology together to explore for oil in a place that has never been explored before. I don't know how to ship the oil. I don't know how to refine it and get it to a place where it's in demand. So instead, I exchange my monetary resources at the gas pump, at the gas station. I benefit from a product that this business offers me. Let's look at the second group of people, which is probably most logical, that critics argue are hurt by businesses or victims of businesses, the employees, the workers, right? Just a show of hands, how many of you work somewhere or have worked somewhere? That's a significant majority of the room, okay. And the argument critics make when it comes to employees is that businesses make a ton of money, right? Take a business like Amazon or Walmart or any major corporation, and they argue that businesses fail to compensate their employees well, right? There are all these rich businessmen who take in all this money for themselves and don't share it with any of their employees, right? But the reality is a business that is successful, a business that's profitable, has the resources to hire and develop its people, right? To pay its employees higher wages, to promote them to have higher level responsibilities. Probably the best example to take would be a fast food restaurant. How many of you work at a fast food restaurant? Okay, not as many as I thought, but a few. So McDonald's, Burger King, Chick-fil-A. Wow, I'm a little surprised. But let's take that example. You probably all eat there at least. And consider McDonald's, Starbucks, and Subway, right? These three fast food restaurants are the top three franchises, at least in the United States, right? It's possible they may be in Canada as well, but at least in the United States. And what I'm talking about is total sales, okay? The total amount of money that these companies bring in a given year. Chick-fil-A comes in at seventh or eighth on the list, right? So after McDonald's, Starbucks, Subway, and a bunch of others in between, and then Chick-fil-A. But the interesting thing is, Chick-fil-A is closed on Sundays, unlike most other restaurants. It also operates less than one-sixth the number of store locations as the top three fast food chains that I just mentioned, so McDonald's, Starbucks, Subway. Despite all of this, on a per-store basis, so each location of Chick-fil-A earns more than any other fast food restaurant in the country. Each Chick-fil-A location is more successful than each McDonald's location or each Starbucks location or each Subway location, at least on average. And so why is this? One of the core reasons Chick-fil-A is so successful is its culture of developing employees who become leaders within the organization, right? So compared to other fast food restaurants, Chick-fil-A employees receive higher quality training. They're better trained throughout their careers. A far higher percentage of Chick-fil-A employees stay with the company for the long term, right? It may not just be a one-year or two-year gig for employees at Chick-fil-A. They may view it as a long-term career path. They may start out in entry-level jobs as a cashier or some other role, but they progress through the organization as an assistant manager, maybe a store manager, and they take on more responsibilities as they progress throughout their careers. And of course, they earn more money, which is what most of us probably would want. Now, for fast food, I almost never used to go to Chick-fil-A myself. I used to go to McDonald's or, you know, Burger King or Wendy's, because the prices were a little bit cheaper than Chick-fil-A. But now, if I want a quick meal, a good meal, I go to Chick-fil-A. Why is that? It's because of the experience I had. Whenever I go to Chick-fil-A, I get a consistent experience. People who work there almost always have smiles on their faces. They serve me well. The food is good. It's better quality than most of the other fast food restaurants. And the experience overall is just a little bit better. I feel good going in and leaving. A successful business has the resources to invest and its employees, which in turn helps the business become even more successful, right? It's a two-way street. There's no reason to view the problem or the equation as having just one winner. But let's take the third group that is often described as victims by businesses, right? And that's the community, community as a whole, which includes all of us, but millions and billions of people around the world. Critics argue that businesses succeed at the expense of the communities they're located in, right? So think of the biggest businesses that are close to where you are. Give me some examples. Walmart, okay, I'm sure probably all of you have a Walmart near you somewhere. What else? Yep. Amazon, okay. Say that again. Microsoft, okay, so Walmart, Amazon, Microsoft. Yep. Apple, okay, you're talking about an Apple store, okay. So let me ask you a question. How many of you want to live in an area that's not growing? No hands, okay. How many of you would not want to move to a place that doesn't offer high quality jobs, the opportunity to earn a high income? Okay. The reality is, not only do businesses disproportionately provide strong jobs and attract talented workers to places around the world, but they also provide for the communities in other very real ways, which you often don't hear about, right? So businesses are taxed by the government, wherever they are. I mean, they're taxed by the government, just like people. In some cases, they're taxed even more. Actually, in many cases, they're taxed even more. Taxes which the government then loves to use for whatever it deems necessary. You never hear about that in the news or in the media. Business owners often give more to charity than others in the community. And we can speak about that here at Young America's Foundation from personal experience. Some of our most loyal and committed supporters here who sponsor programs like this are business owners themselves. They've succeeded through their careers in business, and now they want to give back. In fact, many of them give throughout their lives. They don't wait. But critics of business conveniently leave out the countless benefits that businesses provide. So, customers, employees, and the community. There are other groups, but these are just three logical ones that I thought it made sense for us to discuss. So we've talked about three groups of people which critics of business often portray as victims. And we've explored why these individuals are not harmed by business, but actually helped by them in countless ways. So I just want to pause for a moment there and ask if you have any questions before we continue with the next step of the argument. Any questions? Everything clear? Yep. Sure. So what do you have a specific question? So the question, just for anyone watching online, is could I clarify the argument about businesses not compensating their employees well? So do you have a specific question?
Specifically, what were you trying to say in answer to that argument?
Sure. Well, the answer is pretty straightforward, right? Which is, in order for a business to succeed, it has to compensate its employees well enough. Right? Otherwise, what incentive do people have to work there? You might not be making as much income as you would want right now, but there's a possibility or an expectation that you might down the road if you work hard enough and stay committed to the organization. Yep. Any other questions? Yep. That'd be terrific. So the question was, what would I do about taxes that I'm not actually in control of taxes? I wish I were. It'd be a lot simpler. Do you have a specific question? Or are you talking about national taxes, the federal tax rate, or are you talking about something else? Sure. To help business? Okay, so the question is, what should we do about taxes to help businesses, right? because we've talked about this to a certain extent, that businesses provide the economic growth, the jobs, the opportunities all of us want. So what do we do about taxes? And there's a lot of different approaches to this, but I think that the most logical, most reasonable way to go is a flat tax, right? And what I mean by flat tax is it's the same tax rate for every single individual, right, in the country. And it's the same percentage, whether it's 10 or 15 or something else. It's fair in that sense, right? Fair is a word that's thrown around a lot. But it's the same percentage. So every single person provides for the services of the country at the same percentage. So if you make a lot more money, you provide a lot more money, right? And if you make less money, you provide less money, but it's the same percentage. Whereas now, with our current tax system, at least in the United States, the more you make, the higher percentage you pay, and the less you make, the less percentage you pay. What's often lost in that discussion is the attacks against business people, often who tend to be wealthier than others in the community. The argument is they don't do enough for the rest of us, for the rest of the community, right? But the reality is they already do. We don't think about it that way, but they already provide more towards government services than the rest of society. But we don't often think about it that way. Yep, another question. Sure. So I'm talking about all forms, although there are very, very reasonable arguments and criticisms of big business for sure. But I'm talking about any sort of business. Entrepreneurs who start a small business, who work at a larger business. We talked about some examples like Amazon or Apple, but I'm talking even about smaller businesses in your community. So I want to continue breaking down this argument of people over profits. And let's take the argument just one more step, if you'll bear with me. So some of the critics argue that businesses should actually focus on providing social welfare, right, over increasing their profits, right? So what does that mean? They argue that businesses would make society that much better if they would only focus on improving the welfare of individuals, doing more for people beyond providing valuable products or services, right? And if we really look at this argument, it is extraordinarily disconnected from the reality we experience. How many people do you know that have started a business simply out of the goodness of their hearts, right? That's the only reason they started a business. Okay. Yep. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So basically, what I'm hearing is, in order to succeed, right, as a business, you have to look out for profits as well as providing something of value to society. So, look, the reality is, sure, businesses help people in lots of ways, and you may want to help people when you choose to start a business. But you wouldn't really go forward with that unless there was a path you saw forward for making a financial gain, right? So I want us to consider just one more example of a business that helps make the case for why the role of business is to increase profits, increase its financial success, right? How many of you have heard of Warren Buffett? Okay, almost everyone. And just someone, what do you know about him? Yep. Okay, so Warren Buffett owns a lot of businesses. Yep. He's smart. Okay. Yep.
He's an investor.
Okay, all good answers. So yes, Warren Buffett is a business leader, right? And you've probably all seen him in the news or read something by him. And he runs a company named Berkshire Hathaway. He's one of the most successful business people in the country, in the world. He buys businesses, owns them for a long time, and profits off of them, right? And he's held in high regard by people across business and society I mean, almost to a T, people view him positively, right? And I want to use him as an example, especially because he's not a conservative, right? He's actually quite liberal on many issues. So that's why I want us to talk about him. People in business admire him because of his extraordinary professional success. He didn't come from extraordinary wealth, but he's the third wealthiest person in the world today. He and his business partners own a number of well-known businesses like Dairy Queen, Geico, the insurance company, Duracell, the battery manufacturer. But he's also admired by people outside of the business world, right? Like some other very wealthy people, he has signed on to what's called the Giving Pledge, right? Has anyone heard about the Giving Pledge? Yep. Could you describe what the Giving Pledge is? Sure. So basically, it's a campaign for folks, wealthy people, to sign up and basically agree to give away a substantial portion of their wealth, right, to charitable causes, to things like educating children in poor countries, developing vaccines for diseases, and other noble efforts, right? So Warren Buffett has actually gone beyond this pledge. He has committed to giving away 99% of his wealth, right? He said, 1% of my wealth is enough for my kids. I want them to have enough so that they feel like they can do anything, but not enough so that they choose to do nothing with their lives, right? And so he's committed to do this either during his lifetime or upon his death. But let's take a closer look at how he actually does business, right? Because I think that actually would tell us a lot more about how he thinks and what he chooses to do. So Buffett and his business partner, a guy named Charlie Munger, are great admirers of a company named Costco, right? And they're also part owners of Costco. Costco has tremendous customer loyalty. How many of you or your families shop at Costco? Okay, almost everyone. And I'm guessing it's partly because you probably have siblings or just large families, which makes sense to go to Costco. It's one of the most successful retailers in the world, right? They sell almost anything you can imagine, and it's one of the most successful companies in the world. And if you go to a Costco, you can probably tell this just by looking. The number of people that are there in the parking lot, the long lines, it takes forever to get out of the store with what you want. And it's a reason why 90% of Costco members renew their membership annually, right? 90%, that's a high number. It's often held up as one of the most socially responsible businesses in the world, right? And why is that? They provide healthcare to all of their employees. They close on major national holidays, so people get the day off. And its employees earn some of the highest wages in all of retail, right? Compared to places like Walmart or Target or any number of other places. But here's something you might not have known. Costco is one of the largest sellers of cigarettes in the United States, right? It sells a large volume of tobacco products at affordable prices, okay? So when he was asked about doing business with companies that sell products like tobacco or others that some might consider less than appealing, Warren Buffett said, "I don't believe in imposing my views on business owners and employees." He said, "I'm not their nanny on that. I don't want to control what they do." He stated that he would continue to do business with companies that are successful, that are financially successful. And why wouldn't he, right? I mean, that makes logical sense. He knows that in order to succeed, he has to do business with people that, with businesses that serve people well. And the reality is, millions of people want to purchase tobacco products, and many want to purchase them at a place like Costco, which sells them at an affordable price. So if Costco doesn't serve its customers well, if it doesn't adapt to the demands of customers, it would fail, right? It would become less profitable and less profitable over time. Costco might not sell tobacco. They might not sell sugary drinks, foods with high cholesterol, all of these things we view as negative in some way, or any number of things if it really was focused on providing social welfare. But it continues to do these things. It's focused on profits, right? That's Costco's best guide for succeeding as a business, for serving people well with the products and services they actually want and demand, right? So what is the ultimate takeaway here for us? People over profits is a false argument, right? It's an argument that doesn't stand up to the test of reality, to your experiences, to my experience. There are countless examples which show that free enterprise and the drive to increase profits for businesses serve all people well, even those not directly associated with those businesses or employed by those businesses. So I encourage you to use the examples you may be familiar with in your own lives, in your own communities, to make this case to your friends and peers. The role of business today remains to increase profits. But this, of course, doesn't happen in a vacuum. You can only do that if you serve people well. So what I ask of you is this: the next time you hear the argument that businesses should prioritize people over profits, just be skeptical. Keep your ears open and be skeptical. Challenge your classmates when you hear this argument. When you hear this argument from government officials, especially government officials, don't take them at their word. Ask questions. If you do that, you'll be way ahead of the game. So thank you, and I'm happy to take questions with that. And the microphone is right there, like I said, so feel free to line up to your left-hand side. Who's going to be first? I see someone.
I'm from Canada.
Okay.
So because of that, I can observe, like through news, like everybody else, of the supposed trade war going on between America and China.
Mm-hmm.
And I guess what my question is how would you, do you believe that China's economy is a real economy when compared to an economy like the United States, mm-hmm. or one based off of false pretenses?
Sure. So in case anyone didn't hear, the question is, given the trade war between the United States and China, do I view the Chinese economy as real, basically, right? Whether the numbers that they report, the growth that they report is real, right? And the truth is, look, we can't be certain about the reporting that comes out of China, right? It's a state, it's a government that controls the media and unfortunately controls many of its people, which also means it controls many of the businesses in the country, right? Major businesses in America, in China, are state-owned, right? They're owned by the government, by Communist Party officials. And so just given that, it is very difficult to take the numbers that come out of China at their word. So that's the first thing I would say. Second, China is an incredible story, right, over the decades. This is a country that was dirt poor, but over particularly the last few decades has grown tremendously. I mean, literally millions and millions of people, hundreds of millions of people have come out of poverty. And a big reason for that has been, to whatever extent, the country has opened itself up, right, to trade, to investment, to new ideas and innovation. But it's not quite there yet. And so particularly with your question, as compared to the United States, look, the United States, we have things like the Constitution, we have rights, we have private property rights, for example. And so there's a common understanding of what we can do in the country, right? So how we run our businesses, what our rights are, etc. And so the reporting that comes out of here, you can always trust that far better than a country like China, which is run by the government. Yeah.
Thank you.
Yep.
So my question was just when you talked about businesses not providing compensation for their employees, like proper compensation.
Sure.
What would stop from a business being built up until it almost gains a monopoly on a certain market,
mm-hmm.
And then it being like maybe taking 50% of the jobs in that certain field,
mm-hmm.
and almost forcing people who are interested in working in that field from working for them, even if there isn't complete compensation for them? Like, what would stop a business from gaining that sort of ability to be the only one with that type of job?
Sure. So you can look at examples throughout history, right? There's not a single company or business that I can think of, but correct me if I'm wrong, that has lasted forever, right? I mean, a business sooner or later will fail, right? Because of various reasons. Could be there's a new competitor that provides a better product or service. Could be because the original business was run poorly. Maybe new leadership came in and failed to manage its resources properly. So there's lots of reasons, right? And so like anything else, I mean, a business is only as successful as well as it's run. And so it has every opportunity to fail, right? I mean, that's the idea of a society based on free enterprise. Now, that's not to say there aren't businesses that do that. Of course there are. In the United States there are. You can point to any one of the companies that uses major lobbying efforts, for example, to control government legislation, to regulate certain industries. For example, here in the United States, cable companies are a good example. I myself tried to cut cable last year. And it would have cost me more to cut the contract I had with my cable company than to just keep it for another year and then end the service. So there are certainly examples of businesses that are monopolistic or monopolies, even here in the United States. But the reality is over time that will correct, right? Because there are others in a free system. Now, if you're talking about a place, for example, like China or somewhere else, where it's not quite a system based on equal opportunity, there's very well possibility that monopolies can exist freely. Yeah. Yep.
Can I ask two questions?
Sure.
All right. So my first question is, you were talking about how, in response to the argument that a business that doesn't provide a valuable product to the consumer will not thrive. What would you say in response to examples of businesses that say cut corners, maybe violate safety regulations, things like that, maybe provide, basically use deception,
mm-hmm.
to gain over the competition, and maybe the consumer doesn't know about that?
Sure, that's a fair question. It's a good question. So there's a reason we have a certain level of government in place, right? So let's take foods you might buy at the grocery store, right? Meat, right? Meat is regulated and labeled, right, by government legislation. And I don't just mean whether it's, farm-raised or whatnot, but the quality and the safety standards, right? It's regulated by the government. And so as a consumer, you have a pretty good idea of when you purchase that at the store of what quality and kind of product you're getting. So that's the first thing. There's a certain level of regulation we obviously need, right? I don't think you or I would want to purchase contaminated meat. The second thing I would say is, similar to businesses that may be monopolistic or attempt to, like you said, cut corners, that also will correct over time, right? You might be thinking of a certain example of a business that, quote unquote, cuts corners. But the reality is, over time, consumers are smart enough to figure that out. It might not happen right away, today, mm-hmm. but if a business continues to do that over time, it will come out. And consumers are smart enough because you and I know how to spend our money better than anyone else.
That makes sense. My second question was just not super related to the talk that you were just giving, but just a more general question. What's your opinion on labor unions, and do you think that they're a necessary evil and or a natural consequence of a free market?
Sure. So the question is labor unions and whether labor unions are a necessary part, basically, of business today. And the second part was whether they're
I guess a lot of people view them negatively. So in that sense, I said some people say they're necessary evil.
Sure.
I guess that assumes that you believe that they're evil, which you may not. But the main question is, do you think that they're a natural result of a free economy and a free market and free enterprise, or are they some artificially caused in some way?
Sure. So I would actually view it a little bit differently. And what I mean by that is, if you think about a truly free society, each individual, each of us has the ability to make a decision, whatever is best for us, right? We can choose to work at a place of work if we want. We can choose to leave if we wish. We make those decisions based on what's in our best interest. But when you're talking about labor unions, you're talking about labor unions, but I think what you mean is unions generally, right? And so let's take teachers unions, for example. Teachers unions are obviously very big in the United States, and especially in certain states. I mean, California is a great example. Unions actually restrict people's rights, right? And what I mean by that is, if you are a teacher at a given school, and you're in a state that requires you to be part of a teachers union, as an employed teacher, you have no choice in many cases. You have to pay to be part of the teachers union. If you refuse to be part of the teachers union, you could risk losing your job. You may still have to pay to be part of that union, even if you choose not to take any of the benefits that come along with that. You simply have limited freedom as a member of a union. And that's true all across the board. Anytime a union like that forces a mandate upon its members or even those who are not members, it's taking away rights. And so ultimately, to get back to your question, I don't think it's a result of the free market or free enterprise. In fact, a free enterprise system, like we just talked about, every single person has a right to make their own decisions. It's just not necessary for a union to do that. Unions often are used as, for example, when it comes to teachers, unions are talked about as though representing teachers well, right, for their salaries. So union may say, our teachers are going to go on strike if you don't increase our teachers' salaries by 5% or 10% next year, right? But the reality is each individual has the ability to negotiate their salaries for the year. If you're a high-performing teacher compared to a very low-performing teacher, you have more of an opportunity and maybe more of the freedom to ask for a raise next year, right? Whereas if you're part of a union, you're on the same page. What incentive is there to work harder?
That makes sense. I guess the last part of my question is, it seems to me like unions are formed organically in the sense that it's not like the government is saying you guys need to create a union. You know, workers do that on their by themselves. Teachers do that by themselves.
Sure.
So I guess my question is, I don't see anything in a free market that prohibits them from creating that. And the government isn't telling them to create it, so it's something organically occurring because they're in a free market. So I guess that was my question of...
I see what you're saying. Yeah, I see what you're saying, and you're absolutely right. I mean, there's certainly nothing precluding people from getting together and forming a group. It's basically an organization, a group, a collection of people. So certainly they have every right to exist. What I would debate or disagree with is that they have the right to force others to participate, right? And I think that's an important difference.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you very much.
Yep.
Hi. This is kind of a really broad question, but what are your views on like the more globalized market we see now and the free enterprise you're mentioning? Because some people or like some countries tend to view that the the wider market as either a very good thing or like a very negative thing. Mm-hmm. And so there's been many controversies that I've seen. Mm-hmm. So what would you say about that?
Sure, it's a good question. So the question is basically about globalization today, right? And free trade across the world, whether that's a good thing, whether that's a bad thing. Look, free exchange, free trade is almost always a good thing, right? And we can just take a very simple example. Let's take, medical innovations, for example. We develop some surgeries and medical devices better here in the United States than any other foreign country can. Other countries in Japan or India, for example, develop some medical devices and surgeries and procedures better than we ever could, at least we have up to this date. And so if you were to make the argument that we should simply support what we do here in the United States versus people or businesses in other countries, that would be a tough argument to make, right? Because you would be saying, I refuse the medical life-saving innovations that another country is producing simply because I want to support people here. Now, I will add to that, not every country is a free economy, right? And so there's a difference. So when we're talking about trading with another free country, Switzerland, for example, is more free, or Hong Kong, for example, versus one like China or Japan, which has long had high tariffs on goods that are imported in the country, there's a difference, right? And so we have the right to treat countries differently based on basically how they treat us, right? It's within our rights, it's logical. And so that's what you're seeing now, right, with President Trump and what some call a trade war and some view as something we should have done a long time ago. We're standing up for the rights of Americans and American businesses to be treated fairly, not to get an advantage in any other country, but to be treated fairly. A country like China, which is probably the place where we're engaged in the strongest trade war, has long harmed our business interests, right? Our businesses that maybe open up facilities in China are restricted from doing lots of things. They're forced to share their intellectual property, so the knowledge and innovation they've developed, with the Chinese government, basically, in order to operate there. And so there's a difference, certainly, that we have to recognize between trade with countries that are free and countries that aren't. But in principle, free trade is almost always a good thing because it benefits both parties, right?
Okay, thank you.
You're welcome.
So I want to know your opinion on a company that seems to act like a government.
Mm-hmm. What do you mean by that?
Like, that seems to like enforce laws on their employees or consumers.
So I think it sounds like what you're asking is maybe which companies try to prevent others from maybe succeeding, other businesses from succeeding. Is that what you're getting at?
Yes.
Yeah. I guess I wouldn't give you necessarily one example. There's lots of examples. And it's not always in the most obvious ways, right? So for example, you could take, Amazon or Apple or any number of major corporations. Almost any big business today has a big lobbying arm. And why do they all have lobbying arms, right? It's to represent themselves in front of legislators, government officials, to gain favorable treatment, potentially at the expense of other businesses and competitors that are trying to enter the same space that they're operating in, right? And so I think you can find examples across the spectrum. Certainly some businesses do it more than others, and some do it at the expense of others. But I think you can really find that across the board if you look hard enough. So that's what I would say.
Thank you.
Yep. And we'll make this our last question.
All right. I just was wondering, I think we can all agree that the minimum wage many times inhibits growth for companies and kind of tramples on their rights to choose and their freedom. But do you think that the government or the state should be able to intervene when a company is not paying their workers enough, or if there should be some type of minimum wage or some type of regulation there?
Mm-hmm. So what I hear you saying is two different things, right? The first part of your question is, we generally agree that a minimum wage takes away basically the rights of people to freely exchange, right? Maybe employment for a certain wage. And the second part of your question is, should there be a minimum wage, right?
Yeah, or is there like any point at which the government should come in to make sure that companies aren't abusing it or taking advantage of their workers?
So I would ask you the question in a different way, right? So if we were to institute a higher minimum wage, what should that be? That's sort of the flip side, right, of the question. Should it be $25 per hour? Should it be $50 an hour? $1,000? I see some of you guys smiling. Right? I mean, it seems silly, but it's a reasonable question to ask, because how would I know what the right wage is for a given business to pay its employees and for an employee to accept for working for that business, right? I simply don't have that kind of knowledge, and neither does any government official. And so it really is up to the individuals that are operating in the marketplace to make that decision for themselves. You know, whether we're talking about $3 or $4 an hour, maybe if you're working in a restaurant, the set wage may be $3 or $4, and then you make the rest up based on tips. But if you're working somewhere else, you may be making a lot more per hour. Mm-hmm. So the question is really the same, right? Is does the government really know and have the knowledge to make a decision like that with incomplete information, right? The wage that's set by business and accepted by employees is a decision made by many, many people, right? And so I think we just have to keep that under consideration and understand that the government is not an actor that can make that decision effectively.
Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you very much. Now, we're going to take a quick 5-minute break before we get started with the next session, so feel free to take a restroom break or grab drinks or food, and we'll be back in just a few minutes.